Good morning and welcome to church. The service will begin in about 5 minutes, and we will be playing some music for you in the meantime. Grab your coffee and your orange juice and some bagels and enjoy.
Welcome to worship. We are so glad that you are here with us. Let us know you're here by commenting below in the video. We'd love to hear from you. If you're visiting us, there is a connection card in the video description, along with the message outline, how to give, and of course, your commitment card if you haven't filled that out yet. Again, let us know that you're here in the comments below, and please join us for worship. Thank you.
with me in the rising sun, with me when the day is done. The kindness of your heart, the kindness of your heart, never failing in the night. In your presence I will find the kindness of your heart, the kindness of your heart. It's your goodness, your goodness. Everywhere I turn I see your mercy, your mercy. Chasing after me.
If we're honest,
pretend to be something that you're not. Living life afraid of getting caught. There is freedom found when we lay our secrets down at the cross, at the cross. So bring your brokenness and I'll bring mine. 'Cause love can heal when hurt divides. If we're honest, it could change our lives, it could set us free. It's what we need to be. So bring your brokenness and I'll bring mine. 'Cause love can heal when hurt divides. And mercy's waiting on the other side. If we're honest, if we're honest, if we're honest.
Let us pray. Good and gracious God, we invite you into this space this morning, into our hearts, into our souls. Stir us where we need stirring. Comfort us and bring us hope in your word. Today and always, in your holy and awesome name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. I want to welcome you all to worship. So glad you're with us today. And we're beginning a new series today, and it's called Advent Between Two Worlds. And we begin the season of Advent today. I want to share with you a scripture reading from Jesus, and it's in the 13th chapter of Mark. And it's about the coming of the Son of Man. But in those days, after that suffering, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light. And the stars will be falling from heaven, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. Then he will send out the angels and gather from his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. But on that day or hour, no one knows, neither the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. Beware. Keep alert, for you do not know when the time will come. It's like a man going on a journey when he leaves home and puts his slaves in charge, each with his work, and commands a doorkeeper to be on the watch. Therefore, keep awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come in the evening or at midnight or at cockcrow or at dawn, or else he may find you asleep when he comes suddenly. What I say to you, I say to all, keep awake. The words of Jesus. Let us pray. Lord, we pray at this time that you would silence in each of us any voice but yours, that hearing your word we may believe, and believing your word we may obey your will. These things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So there's this thing that just shows up at my house sometimes. It's the tickle monster. And it shows up mostly at specific times, like when there are toys left on the floor, or when there are dishes that haven't been cleared off the table, or technology limits that have been exceeded. And this thing just shows up. But you can sense it coming. Sometimes you can hear it a little bit. Sometimes you can hear the floor creaking as it approaches. Sometimes you can even smell it when it is just lurking around the corner. Sometimes you just know it is there, that something is about to happen. And unless those toys are picked up, or those dishes are picked up, or the technology is shut up, out comes the tickle monster. Out of nowhere, the tickle monster just seems to possess Dad's body. And sudden, intense tickling of disobedient children begins. And the only escape is if, actually there is no escape. It's too late to escape, and the tickle monster just tickles until the technology is off, or the promises are made to pick up the toys or the dishes or whatever it might be. But promises can be broken, so the tickle monster just lurks until... What the tickle monster does is breaks that focus on the immediate, that screen locked right in front of the face, with the idea that something is coming, and something is impending, and something expected. It gets our mind off of those other things. We don't know when, but it's coming one day when we least expect it. And that's kind of the big idea of the season that we're beginning today, that we call Advent, that something is coming, and that we're supposed to be awake, and that we're supposed to be prepared for the day when it comes. And Advent is way bigger than just, you know, the Christ child that comes at Christmas, and it's bigger than the Christ who continues to come to us in the present. It's the reminder that one day Christ is going to come again. The things as we know it are not going to remain the same. It's prophecy. It's beware, be alert. No, here's what the future holds. So if anyone asks you what Advent is about, I just want to give you three things that it's about. It's about the Christ who comes at Christmas, the child in the manger. We know all about that one. It's about the Christ who continues to come to us through the power of the Holy Spirit, the Christ who speaks to us today. And it's also about the Christ who will come again, that things as we know them will not always be the same, that he has promised to return, and one day he will come again, probably when people are not looking for it. And we're to not only prepare the way, but to watch. That's the big idea of Advent. How do we know? Well, he promised through the prophets, going back thousands of years, prophets such as Isaiah and all over Scripture, that he would come into the world, and what happened? He did. This message was announced by John the Baptist and others that we'll hear from in the weeks to come. And it's the expectancy of the prophets, hoping, dreaming, reminding people that things are not always going to be the way they've always been. Hey, just so you know, things are going to not only improve, but Christ is going to come again, and there's going to be a new day and a better day, and the world is going to be healed. And there's a longing for that day of peace, that day of righteousness, that day of healing, when everything wrong is going to be made right in our world. That's what the second coming of Christ is about. So this season of Advent is expecting that one day that's going to happen, breaking your focus on the immediate, something bigger. Something way beyond our daily concerns, something outside of our control that one day is going to occur. So Jesus' message is, hey, know that that's coming and keep awake for it. It's a message in Mark 13. There is a link to the scripture in the outline. So it's about longing, expectancy. So I have a question for you today. What do you long for? I mean, deep down in your heart, what do you dream about? What do you hope for? What's that unspoken thing that you just long for? And your answer is what? What is it? If we're honest, as the song just said. We all know the obvious answer is we want to end COVID. You know, I hear that all the time. I'm so sick of this. The phrase that I hear is I'm done with COVID. We want a time to re-enter community. We want to fully reopen our businesses. We want to return to normalcy. We know all those obvious answers. And then there are also the individual longings that are within each of our lives. You know, relational reconciliation, financial freedom, you know, vocational accomplishment, the respect of our peers and friends, a return to prosperity, the peace, the search for peace of mind, the search for joy or rest or freedom. You know, those are the things that if we're really honest, you know, we're really looking for. What is it for you? Well, whatever it is for you, here's the message. That the Lord provides a path to that very thing. And the Lord provides the way to that very thing. And he made us and he created us. And he provides endless opportunities and possibilities to experience what he created us to know, to fulfill the deepest longings of the human heart. And just a short passage, a famous one from Isaiah 64, it says this, O Lord, you are our Father, we are the clay, and you are our potter, and we're the work of your hand. Beautiful passage. God is the potter. God made you. We are the clay, the work of God's hand, and God is shaping something, and God has given us the opportunity to be shaped by God. And God has invited us to go down his pathways, to go down the direction that he has invited us to go, to hear his voice, to live in his community, to be shaped by him, to be guided by God's Holy Spirit, the God who comes to us today when we're open and listening and inviting his voice to be present. It's Advent. Hey, by the way, God's doing something. We may not see it, but it's going on. It's happening. God came to us. God continues to come to us. And one day, he's going to come again. So don't forget. So longings, expectancy, what are you hoping? What would you hope that God would do in you? Then, I mean, that also kind of assumes that you believe there's something that you need God to do. Sometimes we kind of live outside of that. What's kind of interesting to me is that people love Advent. And it's kind of a surprise to me, actually. Why do people love Advent? I mean, think about it. I mean, even some of the big mega churches all over the country starting today or next week are going to celebrate this season of Advent, and that is so interesting to me because most of the year, the big mega churches arrange their preaching around the secular calendar, around Mother's Day and Father's Day and Valentine's Day, etc. So why Advent? It's a liturgical season with a Latin name from the 400s. What relevance does it possibly have for today? Well, here's the relevance. It's hope and expectancy and that desire for fulfillment. Those things that we just live with, we're kind of seeking every single day. They probably use Advent because lots of the people in the churches grew up with it, and it speaks to the deepest longings of the human heart. And it uses the simplest metaphor for who Christ is, the light that comes in to the world, the true light that gives light to everyone, it says in John 1, was coming into the world. And we have these Advent wreaths, and each Sunday there's a word, we light them. They represent these human needs, the deepest longings of the human heart for hope, and for peace, and for love, and for joy. People say they find those. What else do you need? And Advent speaks into the dream that people have to make this reality of God's known, God's promises heard, God's kingdom expanded. And a couple thousand years before John the Baptist was even walking the earth, we hear this in Isaiah, a voice of one crying out, "Prepare the way of the Lord in the wilderness, make a straight highway for our God in the desert. Every valley will be lifted up, every mountain and hill will be leveled, the uneven ground will become smooth, and the rough places a plain, and the glory of the Lord will appear, and all humanity together are going to see it." It's a beautiful image. So thousands of years before Christ, hey, this is what God is going to do. And it's amazing that John the Baptist was saying the same, and then it happened. That we're part of God's storyline, that God is bigger than all the little stuff that we see, and we're part of something way bigger that's happening right now. So what's the challenge in Advent? It's to see that big picture, to be awake to what is beyond us, to hear the voice of God's prophet. Hey, just so you know, this isn't all that there is. So since about the 400s, people that follow Christ, Christians, people of faith, people who are seeking to trust in the Lord, have been practicing and marking this season, Advent, because we're people who need hope. And in the 400s, this is how they did it. The idea was to fast for 3 weeks. So celebrate Advent by no food, for 3 weeks, show that you're serious, get your mind off all that food, get it on something that matters. If you take the faith seriously, here's your chance to do that. I'm not doing that. That was the original practice. And maybe you grew up in a church like I did, where they did a lot of stuff around Advent. When I was growing up, we went to church on Sunday mornings during Advent, and we went back on Sunday night during Advent. And we had Advent dinners before worship, and there were big programs, and it was this big time of year. And it's kind of funny, today you can't even get people to attend church on Sunday mornings, much less Sunday morning and Sunday night. So it's just a little different. So then we switched to this thing in churches called an Advent festival, and we'd have one of those during the season of Advent, usually in December. And the first event I ever attended at this church was an Advent festival. I was right over there in that back corner. It was December of 2001. The place was just full of people. And I introduced myself to someone as there was a line of people coming through. And I said, "Hi, I'm Andy." And the person said, "I think you should be called Pastor Andy. Maybe Pastor Romsted." I said, "Okay, whatever you say. Nice to meet you." There were Advent wreaths around and Advent candles. If you're not familiar with those, an Advent wreath has 4 candles in it. And all the children, by the way, have received the opportunity to get a free Advent wreath from the church as a way to practice Advent. I think the pickup for those is today. If you want one, if you have questions, let us know. And it's 1 candle for each of the Sundays leading up to Christmas. And each candle has a meaning, something that your kids need to know, things like hope and peace and love and joy. And you light a candle as a family, and you read a verse, and you remind one another that it's in Christ that those things are found. And on the 5th Sunday, traditionally, you light a 5th candle called the Christ candle. By the way, different traditions have different words for those. I don't know if there's a right order for the words. And maybe you practice something called Advent calendars. In our family, we're doing those with the kids. You know, starting in December 1, you open a little window, you get a piece of chocolate. They're super psyched up about the chocolate. And there's some message that goes with each day reminding you, hopefully reminding you of something that goes beyond the chocolate, beyond the immediate. And a lot of that is lost as the culture moves away from those old traditions. But here's what is not lost, and here's what we lift up. This is the main thing, the voice of the message of the prophet, the voice of the prophet whose message is simply this: what we all know now, what we experience now, is not all that will ever be. And that God will come again, and that this is not all there is. And remember that the storyline is way bigger than our own little personal storylines, the blinders that we live within, that we bury our heads in, focusing in on our own little worlds, and that there's this storyline of creation, and that God has done something, that God is doing something today, and God is going to do something in the future to restore creation, and we're to watch for it. And the message to humanity is simply this: to prepare the way for that coming. And to keep awake, to watch for it, to see it, and to not be sleeping through the good news of Jesus Christ. Hey, it's coming. So in a couple of weeks, we're going to receive the first part of that season, the coming of the Christ child, the true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. And then there's the message beyond Christmas. That's Mark 13:36. Just a short version. Or else he may find you asleep when he comes suddenly. And then verse 37, and what I say to you, I say to all, keep awake, be alert, in other translations. So Advent, just a reminder from the prophets of long ago, prophets that were right, by the way, a warning of sorts. Prepare the way of the Lord in your life. Keep awake for God's presence in your life. That God is not finished in your life or the world. That God is not done with you or the world. God's not done. God will come again. And lurking around the corner, you can hear him, you can sense something coming. God is at work. See it, be awake to something bigger and beyond yourself. Amen. Please pray with me. Lord, this Advent season, we pray that you would open our hearts to see you and to be aware of all that you're doing around us and that which is to come. Help us to focus on you. Give us practices to prepare your way. These things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please join me in praying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Well, just a couple of quick announcements this morning before we have one more worship song. Again, just a reminder that if you are visiting with us today, there is a link for a connection card in the video description if you would be so kind as to fill that out. There are also links for the message outline from today, as well as how to give and your statement of intent card if you have not turned that in yet. Kids Zone online groups have begun for our first through sixth graders. It is not too late to join. Please contact Kate if you need information on that. Now, this Christmas season, if you have people that you want to serve, if you want to serve this season, if you want to give this season, or if you need support this season, please let the church know. We have resources and we have the willingness and the ability to serve those who need it. Again, this morning, thank you so much for joining us. And now, please receive your blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and grant you peace. Amen.
I was blind, now I'm seeing in color. I was dead, now I'm living forever. I had failed, but you were my redeemer. I've been blessed beyond all measure. I was lost, now I'm found by the Father. I was changed from a ruin. I've been given a hope and a future. I've been blessed beyond all measure. Oh, to me.
We just want to thank you for joining us online this week. We hope that you have a wonderful week. We want blessings upon you. May the Lord bless you and keep you. Have a great day.